Hi, if everyone could please find their seats and would kick off our first presentation of the day. We're very excited to have Unilever back at CAGNY, and please join me in thanking the company for sponsoring a break we'll have later this morning. Unilever has an enviable global footprint with almost 60% of its sales coming from emerging markets and 85% of its sales in number one or number two positions. Its initiative, Connected for Growth, has helped the company become more agile in a rapidly changing landscape by launching consumer-centric innovation with greater speed to market. Unilever's target of 20% operating margins by 2020 reflects cost savings as well as continued investments to drive growth. I'm very pleased to introduce Graeme Pitkethly, Chief Financial Officer, to the stage.
Thank you, Janet. Morning, everybody. It's really good to be back here at CAGNY. It's something of a body shock for a Scot to get all this sunshine at this time of year. That's really why I come here. I'm delighted to be here with my colleague Richard Williams. Richard took over from Andrew. If you remember, Andrew is our head of investor relations at the start of this year. Andrew's currently in New Zealand growing a beard, and he's no doubt glued to this webcast and about to score our performance like the ice dancing at the Winter Olympics. So good morning, Andrew. Fingers on the buttons. Richard's going to start with a very quick recap of the fundamental investment case for Unilever, and he's going to give you some highlights of our 2017 performance. I am then going to cover just four topics that, based on the dialogue that we've had with most of you over the course of the last 12 months, we think are pretty front of mind and that are really important to getting an understanding of Unilever today and Unilever tomorrow. But before I hand over to Richard for that kickoff session, I'd like to start with a long-standing CAGNY Unilever tradition that we started last year. And that's to kick off our session with an ad reel. Last year it was a bit of a happy accident, to be honest, because we had to write the deck on the plane on the way over, and we frankly didn't have the technical skills to embed all of our nice advertising into the PowerPoint presentation. So we chucked it all together into a two-minute film and played it to you. And, you know, when you're viewing things from this side of the stage, it really was remarkable last year, because I had a chance to watch all of your faces as you had your morning coffee and watch 2 minutes of the best work that we had done last year. So we thought we'd do it again. We've got 2 minutes for you. Relax and enjoy your coffee. And if we could play the ad reel, that would be great. Thanks.
Fill my cup, put some nigga in it. Take a sip, sign the check. Julio, get the stretch.
Ride to Harlem, Hollywood, Jackson, Mississippi. If we show up, we gon' show up. Smoother than a fresh drop. Just why? Don't believe.
Right, hopefully that's woken everybody up. Good morning. As Graeme said, my name is Richard Williams, and I am the new head of investor relations here at Unilever, and it is great to be here for the first time. First, the usual safe harbor statement. Now, I know that many of you follow Unilever closely, but for those who are less familiar with our story, I thought I'd briefly set out our enduring strengths and our investment case. We're committed to a long-term investment-led growth model built on four enduring strengths. Firstly, a strong portfolio of purpose-led global brands and iconic local jewels. 85% of our sales are generated from either the number one or number two position in the categories and countries that we operate in. This is a vital position of strength in any category, in any market. Secondly, the widest and deepest global footprint in our sector. Our products are available in 190 countries around the world, and we have close to 60% of our business in attractive emerging markets, which Graeme will talk about later. Thirdly, and connected to our footprint, the breadth of our distribution. We reach 2.5 billion consumers every day through 30 million outlets globally. And we have broad channel expertise that we are always working to strengthen and develop. Finally, we believe we have the most international, diverse, and balanced management team of any in our industry. This applies both to the diversity in our global teams and to the deep experience in our local markets. In fact, more than 80% of our country leadership teams in emerging markets come from that country. It's this combination of global diversity and deep local expertise which is so powerful when it comes to developing strong, consumer-relevant innovation and delivering it to the market at the right time. We've set out our clear targets for 2020. We expect to deliver underlying sales growth ahead of our markets. In current market conditions, we expect this to translate to around 3 to 5% per year. At the same time, after a period of catch-up in investment in our brands, manufacturing base, and portfolio, we plan to increase our underlying operating margin to 20% by 2020. We expect to convert 100% of our underlying net profit into free cash flow and maintain the capital efficiency and strategic flexibility of a leverage ratio of 2x net debt to EBITDA. And we expect to sustain a high ROIC in the high teens. Underpinning this investment case is the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. It helps drive sustainable, long-term value creation. The 2017 results put us well on track to achieve these 2020 targets, so I'll just take a few minutes to recap. 2017 was another year of major change with the acceleration of the Connected for Growth program and the implementation of a more agile, locally empowered, consumer-facing organization. At the same time, we delivered good all-round performance. Underlying sales grew 3.5%, excluding spreads. Volumes were up 1%, and we've been clear on our priority to raise this in 2018. In fact, there was an encouraging pickup in volumes in the fourth quarter, reflecting the benefits of Connected for Growth. Our innovations are going faster to market, and we've steadily increased the level of reinvestment of savings. Our underlying operating margin stepped up by 110 basis points to 17.5%. We realized more than $2 billion of savings from our gross margin program, 5S, and from zero-based budgeting. This sets us well on track towards our objective of 20% underlying operating margin by 2020. Underlying earnings per share grew by 11%, and we delivered another step up in free cash flow to $5.4 billion. Even after a one-off contribution of $0.6 billion into our pension funds. So, a good all-round performance in 2017 with plenty of other performance highlights. The number of local innovations was up by more than 50% year on year, and we launched 6 new brands. This is testament to the simpler, faster, and more empowered organization that we've put in place. We made 11 acquisitions, which collectively had grown at double-digit rates, and we announced the disposal of our spreads business. The significant step-up in profit and lower net capital expenditure enables us to continue to evolve our portfolio through M&A while still sustaining a high ROIC of 19%. Our e-commerce turnover grew by 80% and is now approaching 2 billion euros. Our sustainable living brands delivered volume growth that was almost twice the company average. Finally, and perhaps most importantly for the long term, we are now the number one FMC graduate employer of choice in 44 of the 52 countries where we measure this. That's up from 34 in 2016. These proof points are evidence that the actions we're taking today position us well to seize the opportunities of tomorrow. And I think that's a good point to hand back to Graeme.
All right, thank you, Richard. So as I said earlier, I'd like to cover four big topics, if you like, which I think are really super relevant to understanding Unilever today and indeed tomorrow. First of all, I'd like to cover the importance of big, strong, purpose-led brands in a world which is becoming much more fragmented, both more global and also more local at the same time. Secondly, I'd like to talk about our emerging markets footprint and the tremendous growth opportunity that brings to Unilever. Thirdly, I'd like to talk about how we're changing our business quite fundamentally to seize the opportunities from fragmentation in the retail and media landscape around us. And finally, I'd like to talk about the fundamental attractiveness of our value creation model, how our targeted savings programs allow us to fuel both our growth and our margin, even as we continue to reshape our portfolio. So first of all, the role of brands. We all know that the barriers to entry are lower than they were in the past, and that communication clutter is much higher. This only increases the relevance for strong brands that can cut through all that clutter and really connect with the consumer. What's needed are well-differentiated and well-communicated brands that are able to hold and build their share of physical and mental availability across all of the media and distribution channels, particularly in e-commerce channels, which I'll come back to in a minute or two. Unilever is a company, or I guess technically now two companies at the moment, of purpose-led global brands and iconic local jewels. These are well-positioned on their own, but what makes them all the stronger is the fact that they sit as part of a portfolio. About 70% of our turnover today comes from the global brands. That's brands like Dove or Knorr, both of which are well over 4 billion euros today in turnover, and in fact growing well ahead of the Unilever average. In fact, in 2017, the volume growth of our five biggest brands was twice as high as the Unilever average. And I think that goes some way to demonstrate the continuing strength and strong consumer relevance of big purpose-led brands, which enjoy scale benefits and are also a platform that will allow us to incorporate technology with our innovations. The other 30% of our turnover comes from either exclusively local brands or from local adaptations of the global brand platforms. Now, this allows us to meet a broader range of consumer needs and meet the demand in our markets for greater local provenance and authenticity. As you can see from the chart, some of these iconic local jewels have been in our portfolio for a very long time. An example is Lakmé Color Cosmetics in India, or the Bango soy sauce brand in Indonesia. Others are brand new brands like Love, Beauty and Planet or Apothecare, which we've just launched here in the United States. Over time, these brands get picked up, of course, and rolled out to more markets, like Breyers Delight, which launched in the US last year and is just now being rolled out to Europe. Now, in addition to homegrown global and local brands, we improve our portfolio with acquisitions to catch evolving consumer demand in faster-growing segments and channels. And we're often asked, you know, how do you decide between M&A or an innovation? Well, to illustrate our thinking, let's look at the profile of the brands that we have acquired. They usually take us into new or adjacent segments, like plant-based home care, air purification, or organic snacking. Most of these brands have been around for somewhere between 5 and 10 years. They've been very, very carefully built and nurtured by passionate and committed founders over time. Nurtured up to the point where they have a very good share of the particular segment that they're operating in. And that's important because it really proves the brand's relevance. Now, almost anybody can launch a brand today, but not many of those launches actually succeed. And it's particularly challenging in segments that are still relatively new. Success requires patience and a true owner's mindset. In our model, it wouldn't be efficient at all to experiment for many years behind ideas that have a high risk of failure. So M&A makes sense to us where it gives us access to ideas that have already worked in the marketplace and where we think that we can scale to the next level, often with the founders still involved. We've been building up an innovation system which accepts that good ideas can come, frankly, from anywhere. It could be our homegrown innovation from our marketeers and R&D working together. It could be open innovation with our suppliers. Or it could be the acquisition of brands as they start to show viable scale. Or it could be Unilever Ventures taking positions in early stage businesses. Or indeed the Unilever Foundry tapping into the startup community. With the implementation of Connected for Growth, the Connected for Growth program, and a much leaner, more agile consumer-facing Unilever, we're seeing the benefit in the quality and in the speed of our innovation. To bring this to light, let me use the example here of a new local brand launch. It's called Hijab Fresh in Indonesia. What happened was that we identified a portfolio gap in the value skincare segment in Indonesia. A very small cross-functional team came up with a new brand concept here called Hijab Fresh, and within only 8 months, they were able to take this concept from idea to launch in the marketplace. They designed a mix that appeals to Muslim millennials. They adapted the pack and formulation of a brand called Pure Line, which is one of our existing brands in Russia. And they made the most of all of our global technology, in this case, our encapsulated fragrance technology. This brand, Hijab Fresh, now plays alongside our global portfolio and successfully fills that consumer gap that we had identified. Greater empowerment of our local teams through Connected for Growth has not only led to new local brands, but importantly also to much stronger local insights flowing into relevant innovation on the global brands. I've got two examples of that I could share. Both of them are in Europe. In Italy, our Italian business launched a vegan variant of the ice cream Cornetto. And in 2018, that's going to be rolled out across the rest of Europe now. A second example is our team on the ground in the Netherlands. They invented Lipton iced tea ice cream for the local market, but it was a big hit, and it's now going to 18 other markets this year. This shows that innovation on the global brands, inspired and delivered locally, can indeed go global. It's perhaps harder to see how the Connected for Growth program also makes us more global. The key here is more focus, creating more capacity in our system. With our local teams now fully empowered to manage the smaller innovations, our global teams have got more capacity to focus on making the global launches bigger and better. They're also now more tightly and directly connected to the local teams under the Connected for Growth design, so they can ensure that the global innovations land with a bigger impact and the right mix. And a good example on the chart here is the relaunch of Dove deodorants. It's now in 65 markets. It's a very strong global mix, but it's communicated in a locally relevant way, as you can see here in Brazil and in Indonesia. Now, second topic. You're no doubt hear a lot this week about the U.S. market. Now, for Unilever, the U.S. market is very important. It accounts for just over 15% of our turnover. It's a market where we have consistently invested over the past few years to fundamentally improve our business. And we've built up our category strength. For example, we've assumed leadership in daily hair care and in ice cream. We've extended our leadership in deodorants and we're gaining share in our dressings business. We've also been investing in new brands and new channels to fundamentally change our portfolio in North America faster and make sure that we're better positioned where that future growth is. But for today, I'd like to focus on what is, in fact, a much bigger part of Unilever, and that is our emerging markets business. Today, 60% of our sales and a little bit more of our underlying operating profit comes from the emerging markets. And we expect this to increase even further, especially given that 6.4 billion people, or as it says here, 85% of the world's population lives in these markets, and that's only going to grow. The IMF estimates that there will be, in fact, another 300 million people, 300 million consumers, and that's another US, I guess, in the emerging markets by just 2021. And that compares to, frankly, hardly any population growth at all in the world's developed markets. Now, population growth highlights only one part of the opportunity. The opportunity gets even bigger when you view it through the lens of income growth. GDP per capita is expected to grow by 25% in the emerging markets in the period to 2021. There are going to be more people entering the middle income bracket, driving up per capita consumption of our products. And there will be more people living in cities with more kitchens and bathrooms to be cleaned. Emerging markets have been and will continue to be absolutely fundamental to Unilever's growth. Over the past 25 years, these markets have delivered, on average, 9% underlying sales growth, with more than half of that 9% coming from volume. And while the last few years have been a little bit below this trend, we're starting to see encouraging signs of a pickup. With close to 60% of our sales in the emerging markets, we benefit from a natural tailwind when consumers in those markets are starting to do well. This advantage makes our growth very broad-based. It gives us a simply fantastic demographic growth platform for the future, and it also creates a portfolio effect so that the inherent volatility of these markets is mitigated a little bit in our overall financial performance. If you like, you get all the good exposure of these markets without all of the volatility. While our businesses benefit from population growth and rising income levels in the emerging markets, we also continue to increase distribution even in our biggest tier one markets on the left-hand side of this chart. For example, in India, we've added 120,000 new stores over just the last 3 years. Or in China, where our strong and winning e-commerce business enables us to reach new consumers and now represents 15% of our turnover in China. We're also seeing really good growth in what you might call our Tier 2 emerging markets. These already represent 20% of Unilever's turnover and have been growing at over 8%. The positions on the chart in the middle box are sort of indicative of relative size, but given the growth rates and strength of our businesses in, for example, Vietnam and in Pakistan, we can fully expect them to continue to move on up this table year after year. In all of these countries, we are focused on market development just as much as we are on winning market share. That means building these markets by driving more users, more usage, and more benefits. As you can see from the Lifebuoy example in the charts, we have a lot of experience and history in doing this, and we have developed and used some very proven models for continued market development. We've been doing that for very many years, and it's very important. Let me turn now to my third topic, which is the opportunity for growth from all of the fragmentation that's going on in media and retail channels. In a nutshell, digital technologies give us an unprecedented opportunity to get our strong brands and their messages closer to the consumer in a much more relevant and a much more personalized way. Technology, and the rise of mobile in particular, has fundamentally changed the way that our consumers interact with our brands. We have more media options across more devices than ever before, and we can choose the content that is most relevant to us, creating our own content and curating that of others. Now, this combination of a fragmenting media landscape and changing channel landscape is fundamentally changing the consumer's path to purchase. It's no longer linear, that's for sure. Our consumers are much more sophisticated with multiple touch points along the way, but sometimes only one click from discovery to purchase. The new consumer journey may or may not involve a trip to a store, but it very often starts with search as the fundamental point of entry, and it might be quite a complex research process that uses multiple devices. Reviews and opinions from social communities about a product play a very large part now in the process, and we increasingly find that word of mouth and online reviews are some of the greatest influencers of purchase decisions. But the journey leaves a data-rich trail that is full of relevant opportunities for a strong brand to engage with the consumer. Understanding this data trail and being able to act on it unlocks a huge opportunity to be more targeted and more personalized with communication, and therefore much more relevant than ever before. As consumer journeys become more digital and fragmented, the quality of our advertising content and the reach that we achieve with it remain fundamentally the two most important drivers of return on investment. Today, we plan multi-screen and multimedia to deliver reach, impact, and relevance. Now, over the past 5 years, the mix of our advertising spend has certainly shifted. Digital media spend has increased by 130%, while the cost of creating digital assets has also increased by 60%. Traditional media costs a little bit less in absolute terms, while efficiencies in traditional asset creation have led to a 35% reduction in the cost of producing each asset. What you might choose to call digital advertising, and I wouldn't necessarily do that anymore, now represents about a third of our total advertising spend. ZBB, zero-based budgeting, has equipped us to clearly identify where we are positioned relative to our cost benchmarks. And that allows us to make really sharp choices about where to invest to drive our growth model for the long term. For example, with ZBB, we targeted substantial cost reductions for communication asset creation. But we continue to build our brand equities with increased media investment, in effect, showing fewer, better assets to more consumers for longer. This ensures that our media investment remains very competitive and that it drives our growth. I'll come back in a minute to show how ZBB has improved the quality of our brand investment last year in 2017. We've adjusted the way that we plan media and reach consumers against all relevant touch points of this more complex consumer journey. It really isn't about traditional or digital media. It's about multi-screen media planning. 5 years ago, the idea of digital was very relevant with quite a clear distinction between offline and online media. In that environment, we spent about 15% on digital and about 85% on traditional media, and we considered that the right split at the time in order to, what we always do, maximize reach. Today, we see less relevance in the traditional versus digital distinction. The most effective media channel can vary. It can vary between category, it can vary between geography, it can vary between brands, and indeed it can vary between the overall objective of any campaign. And what we find is that in order to optimize our reach, we have to take a very holistic approach and amplify messages across multiple media channels. And of course, there'll be a different ROI against each of them. Just to give you a couple of examples, winning in search is, of course, increasingly crucial to capture consumers' attention at the start of their journey. TV and video remains by far one of the best ways to cut through, but it is relatively expensive to create. Good social posts are one of the most difficult things to do well, but if you do them well, they'll give you some of the highest ROIs. And good display is really most effective in closing sales right at the point of purchase. The output of optimizing all of these ROIs is that one-third of our media spend is, as I said earlier, digital by our conventional definitions. While we've seen a lot of change in the last 5 years, we can all expect to see even bigger change over the next five. None of us has a crystal ball anymore, so please take this chart as directional only. But it does seem a safe bet that the level of online to offline integration is only set to keep increasing. And while you can predict that we will be talking less about television, there is absolutely no doubt that most of us will continue to watch moving pictures on some form of rectangular screen going forwards. No matter how much the media landscape changes, we see great opportunity for strong, purposeful brands, and the ROI will remain the driver of our media allocation as we seek to optimize the reach of our content across multiple platforms with more tailored and relevant messaging. To seize this opportunity, we continue to invest in building new capabilities. The first is data capability at scale through our people data centers. These now provide real-time consumer insight in 20 markets and enable our goal, which is to build 1 billion one-to-one relationships, with the emphasis here on relationships and not just data records or cookies. The second capability we're building is reinventing consumer engagement through U-Studios. The U-Studios allow us to create more relevant and personalized content in a much more efficient way. We now have U-Studios up and running in 17 markets, and to date they've run more than 3,000 projects across 200 of our brands, and they've done all that very, very efficiently. The third capability is media buying. We do that through Ultra, which is our proprietary trading desk for programmatic. Ultra gives us the edge to reach the right consumers with the right context at the right time, all at the best price. In summary, we have better insights generated earlier, we have more relevant content generated and created faster, and we plan media more efficiently and effectively than we did before. Let me turn now from media to channels. We see not only changes in how consumers make brand choices, but also in where they shop those brands. That makes it even more important to have the right portfolio and the right channel strategy to win with every shopper. Let's look at what's changing and how this will influence our channel footprint. We do, of course, see less reliance on the traditional weekly shop, but we do still expect supermarkets to be our largest channel for many, many years to come. And within this channel, there are some vectors of very strong growth, such as discount and convenience. We also see continued strong growth of the traditional trade in our emerging markets, driven by the macro trends that I spoke about earlier. These are the mom-and-pop stores. They're the warungs and tokos in Indonesia, the kirana in India. And that's where our deep, deep distribution and experience plays most. What is changing, though, in both the developed and the emerging markets, is that we all shop more frequently and across more channels than ever before. And while differentiated shopper missions means that each channel must focus on meeting those shopper expectations, we focus on the consumer wherever they choose to shop as part of an omnichannel approach. Now, 5 years out from now, we expect that around 30% of our turnover will come from e-commerce and our own experience platforms. That's a grand name for things like our own physical brand stores, our very powerful out-of-home ice cream business, our food service business, etc. But from a store's perspective, it's things we have with T2, Ben & Jerry's, St. Ives, Magnum stores, etc. That channel, that means 30% of our turnover, that's a doubling from around 15% in 2012. We saw a lot of opportunity in the rapidly growing channels. For example, health and beauty gives us the opportunity to step up product education and to drive trial. Our own brand stores drive our brand equity through physical performance spaces, and that's an alternative to building brands through media investment. It also helps you cut through the clutter that I mentioned earlier. Have a physical space, people can see, people can engage, people can see the brand perform. E-commerce opens up distribution, and it allows our marketing to be ever more relevant to the individual. We think we are best placed to win in this dynamic channel landscape. We can do it today and we can sustain it for the long term, creating a lot of value for everyone connected to our business, and that's a lot of connections. We will keep building on our strengths. In supermarkets, we will keep focusing on strong joint business plans with our retail partners, on consumer expertise driving category value creation, and net revenue management drives smart pricing. In the traditional trade, we'll keep pioneering and innovating. We'll equip our sales forces and our distributor partners with new technology that builds their businesses and our business together, as we always have done. We will keep investing in different ways behind our brands, like the experience platforms, or shops and chefs, as I like to call them, which, though we expect to grow 50% faster than the rest of the business. In Food Solutions, our B2B food service business, we're digitizing our business model to achieve higher customer satisfaction with our professional chefs. In Health and Beauty, we have historically under-indexed there, but we're reworking our channel model right through from the portfolio we have to our go-to-market approach with a goal of double-digit growth in that channel. And we expect e-commerce to contribute as much as 40% of our total growth, so we continue to invest to build capability and build our portfolio across the different formats, whether that's online grocery, pure-play e-commerce, or direct-to-consumer. And we're confident that whatever e-commerce model develops fastest in a particular geography, we have the right capability, we have the right brands, and we have the right talent to continue to win fair share or better within that channel. Now, a more channel-centric consumer means that we need to bring our customer teams even closer to our marketing teams through Connected for Growth. We do that so that we can produce more innovation which is tailored to particular channels. Let me give you some examples. In Health and Beauty, we extended Dove into face care with a proposition that puts back moisture and nutrients in every wash. Our new brands, Apothecare and Love Beauty and Planet, enable us to build scale in the Health and Beauty channel. In direct to consumer, we're building our capabilities through innovative business models like Dollar Shave Club and T2. In China, we've launched Keju by Lux exclusively in the e-commerce channel. That was co-created with a Korean designer to meet the K-beauty trend with urban millennials in China. Or in the UK, we launched 4 Amazon laundry bundles, which is a good example of understanding the algorithm to win in search and tailor our offerings. In the discounter channel, where price point is so very important, we've produced discounter-specific packs that allow us to target a lower recommended sales price whilst maintaining our gross margin. Examples are Shure in the UK, which is Degree here in the US, which launched a product with a recommended retail sales price at a £1 price point just by removing some of the premium technology and reducing the complexity of the artwork on the pack. The last of my 4 themes, how we deliver both growth and margin, and our strategy for keeping our portfolio positioned for growth through M&A. Critical to the delivery of both growth and margin is our Connected for Growth program. This brings a number of fundamental changes to Unilever. First, it's a new organization that raises our innovation capability to meet consumer trends with speed and scale, and doing that both globally and locally, as I explained earlier. Secondly, the accelerated evolution of our portfolio and our channels, both organically and through M&A. And thirdly, the global rollout of the 5S program in the supply chain and the benefits of continued discipline and efficiency through zero-based budgeting. The Connected for Growth organization is making us much simpler, much more agile, and much more consumer-facing. Connected for Growth brings even greater divisional focus. The setup of the country category business teams result in better alignment between the countries and the categories and help us to ensure that category strategies are implemented very well at country level in the front line of our business. The integration of foods and refreshment allows us to further sharpen the organization and the resources required for that business to compete with the very best food and nutrition businesses in the world. We've also redesigned all of our functions. A few examples are global and local marketers who used to operate as 2 teams are now much better connected with much clearer decision rights. Our sales teams get involved earlier in the innovation process to bring in more channel expertise. And our supply chain teams are becoming more agile with much greater use of third-party manufacturing. Alongside innovation, a critical element of our strategy is to continue to develop the portfolio through what we call bolt-on M&A. That shifts us more quickly towards future trends, and it increases our exposure to higher growth segments. Responding to a faster changing consumer, we picked up the pace of portfolio change significantly with 22 acquisitions completed or announced since the start of 2015. Some acquisitions have taken us into adjacent categories, and some help us to fill geographic white spaces faster, giving us new scale in future growth markets. Others bring in new channel capabilities or greater relevance with millennial consumers. As well as moving to higher growth segments, we continue to actively manage our portfolio by exiting brands or categories that no longer fit with our long-term strategy, like our low-growth spreads business. This repositions our portfolio towards more attractive and faster-growing segments. By 2019, the acquisitions that we've made since 2015 will add 3.5 billion euros of turnover. 3 billion euros of that will be in home and personal care. 2 billion euros of it will be in premium positions. 1.5 billion euros of it will be in the emerging markets. And nearly 1 billion euros will be conducted through e-commerce. In total, we expect that the combined impact of the acquisitions to date, plus the disposal of spreads, will add around 1% to our ongoing underlying sales growth by 2019. Our model is first and foremost a growth-driven one. We're fully focused on accelerating growth and growing ahead of our markets with no compromises or irrational trade-offs. For several years now, we've shown that we can indeed consistently grow ahead of our markets, typically by around about 1 percentage point. In addition, we expect that the portfolio evolution through M&A that I just explained will add a further 1% to our ongoing underlying sales growth from 2019. And putting these together, connected for growth and accelerated portfolio change, give us the basis to reconfirm our guidance of 3 to 5% annual underlying sales growth. A critical enabler of our value creation model are our savings programs. We expect these to deliver 6 billion euros of savings in the period from 2017 to 2019, and that provides the fuel for both growth ahead of the market and an underlying operating margin of 20%. We are well on track to deliver this, on also our target of 100% free cash flow conversion. Our return on invested capital, our ROIC, of 19%, that includes all acquired goodwill, and it remains one of the best in our sector and an area where we continue to be very focused. Delivery of our 2020 margin target would, of course, improve our ROIC even further. However, reshaping the portfolio towards faster growth segments and channels through M&A brings more goodwill onto the balance sheet, and this always has a diluting effect on ROIC in the initial years. The good news is that this can be accommodated overall by the accretion to ROIC from our growth and our margin expansion opportunity. So we can create the headroom for faster portfolio change while maintaining very high returns for our shareholders. And of course, we are convinced that growing our business faster for longer while sustaining a high teens ROIC creates more absolute value overall than simply maximizing our ROIC in the short term. We've been asked a lot of questions in the past year about whether our planned margin improvement is sustainable. So let me spend a final few moments explaining our savings programs in just a little more detail. 4 billion euros of our cost savings between 2017 and 2019 will come from the supply chain, and the lion's share of these will be delivered through what we call our 5S program. 5S is a holistic program. It's about pricing. It's about mix. It's about buying, and it's about partnering. It's about how we source our products, how we design our products, and what the core product platform is. We apply it now across all of our categories and make structured interventions, what we typically call a design-to-value initiative. You know, it's relatively easy to cut the cost out of a product, but it's pretty difficult to do it without affecting the product's quality, the product's functionality, and hence the overall consumer experience. Design to value helps us to understand in detail the attributes of our products that are most important for the consumer, and those that are in fact less relevant. It then looks at the end-to-end supply chain cost from raw materials to distribution, and it allows us to take cost out without affecting, and indeed sometimes even improving, the consumer experience along the way. 5S is very fact-based. It's grounded in a cross-functional approach, and it leads to really great results. The slide here just shows one example that led to a 900 basis point gross margin improvement in Lux soap bars through a more efficient bar design, a consolidation of our fragrance suppliers, and by introducing a better but lower cost formulation. Moving to brand and marketing investment and overheads, we expect to deliver 2 billion euros of cost savings in that period from 2017 to 19. ZBB and our new C4G organization are really working hand in hand to make our spend work harder by improving the mix of investment and by cutting less effective spend. In 2017, we held our overall BMI, brand and marketing investment, flat, as we said we expected to. But if you look under the hood, you can see that we actually increased the amount of consumer-facing media and in-store activation by around 250 million euros, whilst reducing our advertising production spend by 170 million euros and banking a further 70 million euros of efficiencies by improving the ROI on brand promotions. This was all delivered in a way that we are confident does not impact the consumer. For example, we reduced the sheer number of adverts that we created in 2017 by 25%, by a quarter. And we reduced the cost of producing each asset by reusing existing brand assets and by making better use of lower cost production locations. U Studios helps quite a lot there. Similarly, across our overheads base, our simpler and more market-empowered organization, which is first and foremost about growth, also resulted in a 15% reduction in the numbers of middle and senior management. We also reduced our consultancy and contractor costs by close to 40% last year. But as important as the absolute cost reduction has been the change in mindset at Unilever. And this is evident when we look at travel costs. Now, that's a relatively small but highly symbolic cost bucket in Unilever, and where we already benchmarked pretty favorably. Nevertheless, as part of ZBB, we've reduced our travel costs by 14% in 2017, with the cost per flight taken coming down by 20%. All of this has contributed to an improvement in our cost base and enabled us to invest in new business models and the channel and media capabilities that I talked about earlier. So just to summarize, strong brands, ones that can cut through, matter ever more in today's world. They matter more than ever. Unilever has a very strong portfolio of purpose-led global brands and iconic local jewels, supported by a very well-developed innovation system, deep channel expertise, and content-driven marketing. Emerging markets have been and will be the driver of growth in the world. We are best positioned to tap into this with unparalleled presence and breadth across those markets. Fragmentation in media and sales channels is a huge opportunity. We're building world-class digital capabilities to seize that opportunity to get our brand messages closer to our consumers. And finally, our value creation model is one of superior long-term compounding value creation, driven first by growth, but also by margin expansion. This is enabled by the Connected for Growth organization, targeted savings programs, delivering 6 billion of savings by 2019, and an accelerated evolution of our portfolio and our channels organically and through M&A. Just before we move to Q&A, let me briefly recap our 2018 outlook. It's the same that we gave with our full year results earlier this month. Underlying sales growth ahead of the market, and we think that's going to be in the 3 to 5% range. We expect this to include a greater contribution from volume than in 2017, lower price growth, particularly in the first half of the year. Multi-year delivery remains our focus, not short-term expectation management. We expect continued progress towards our margin target of 20% by 2020, fueled by our savings programs. Progress won't be linear, but there will be more restructuring over time as we start to take out stranded costs for spreads and complete the build of our new foods and refreshment division. We will continue to maintain competitive levels of brand and marketing investment. Compared to 2017, we expect that the spend will be more weighted towards the first half in 2018. and we are going to target another strong year of cash flow and high returns. Thanks very much for your attention, and I think we've got a bit of time, Janet, for some questions.
I think we're actually out of time, so we'll move Q&A to breakout. But thank you so much, Graeme and Richard, for a great presentation and for sponsoring the break.